I'm just a guy who loves Disney and has way too much time on his hands. If anybody from Disney is watching, please don't sue me. I'm here to rate, review, and describe all of your favorite things from the magical world of Disney. I'm File91e, and welcome to my Disney news and reviews. Hello everyone, and welcome to this week's Disney news and reviews. I'm File91e, and a soggy, rainy weekend here in Baltimore, but the rest of the week was pretty good. I had it was a good positive week, positive energy flowing. I liked it. I liked where it was going. We got the 4th of July coming up next week, so I'll have a special couple reviews for that. Very patriotic themed for all the American viewers. Any foreign viewers, obviously they won't understand the whole 4th of July thing. Well, they might understand it, but they won't, you know, really care. But yeah, so I got two kind of patriotic themes coming up next week. And one other thing that I'm thinking of doing is for August, I want to do a kind of a battle arena sort of thing where I compare different attractions from Walt Disney World and Disneyland. You know, like what's better, the Disneyland version of Space Mountain or the Disney World version of Space Mountain. So I'm thinking of doing something with that. If I can get the filming all correct, it'll be something special. So hopefully you guys will enjoy that. So you'll get to hear my opinions on why one is better than the other. So I might do something fun with that just to try to spice this channel up a little bit. And just real quick, the Where in the Land from last week was the Astro Orbiter. I think that was a pretty good, I tried to conceal it pretty well, but you guys got it, obviously. The Astro Orbiter in Tomorrowland in Disneyland. So yeah. So we're still doing the summer stuff. It's still, you know, summer's getting hot. It was hot here, but now it's kind of cooling down. But we got a lot of, you know, thunderstorms and whatnot. So I'm going to be talking about, aside from the patriotic stuff next week, I'll be doing some summer things. I'll talk about the Disneyland Hotel and the water park in that area, because there's, you know, stuff there. And there's also some other rides that are, I guess, summer themed, you know, like Screamin', California Screamin'. And if you have any, ideas for summer themed rides that you would like me to review, whether it be from Disneyland or Disney World, just let me know. And you might see it in the next couple weeks, so who knows. So yeah. And I think I need to do like a Q&A or something soon. So maybe at the end of the summer, or maybe I'll just do one randomly. I just haven't done a live show in a while. And we'll see how that goes. It's just, everything's been hectic with my grandmother being in the hospital and all. So it's just, yeah. But, we'll just see how that goes. So yeah. Yeah, that's what's been going on with me this week. Let's get right to the news. Well, it's that time of year again, and the Walt Disney World Resort will be celebrating Independence Day with the special fireworks displays, patriotic character meet and greets, and music concerts on July 3rd and July 4th. So, listen up. I want to break down where things are going to be and in which parks. In the Magic Kingdom, the Disney's Celebrate America, a 4th of July concert in the sky, will be performed at 9 p.m. on both July 3rd and July 4th. Park hours will also be extended on those days, so the fun can continue. A lot of them are extra magic hours, so be diligent on looking at that. And this fireworks show is pretty spectacular. They use everything. It's a big wide angle show. It's, you know, it's pretty spectacular. In Disney's Hollywood Studios, the Rockin' 4th of July Celebration fireworks show will be at 10:15 p.m. on July 4th. With longer operating hours. So again, probably extra magic hours and stuff like that. So just be diligent on looking at the hours. You might be able to get a couple extra hours in. And finally, in Epcot, Illuminations Reflection of Earth with the July 4th finale will happen at 10 p.m. on July 4th. There are extra magic hours that extend to midnight as well. Also, the Voices of Liberty will perform a 4th of July concert at the America Gardens Theater at 12:30 p.m., 1:45 p.m., and 3 p.m., and in the American Adventure Pavilion itself at 4:15 p.m. and 5 p.m. So they usually do some really fun stuff with that, so check that out. And special patriotic character greetings are also available at various times throughout the day at the American Adventure. So that's cool. You know, 4th of July is coming up. Disney likes to do it up nice, so if you're down there during that time, check this stuff out. It's really cool. As you may have already heard, the new selfie stick phenomenon will now be eradicated from all Disney parks. Worldwide, everywhere, all the Disney parks ever. As of June 30th, actually, in the foreign parks, it'll be July 1st. So, you know, June 30th, July 1st, that sort of thing. No more selfie sticks. Disney is adding the selfie stick to the list of items that are not permitted into the parks. The previous policy only had banned the use of selfie sticks on the rides. You could use them in the parks, but you couldn't use them on the rides because people, for whatever reason, decided that the middle of, you know, Big Thunder Mountain was the perfect time to take a selfie. So they would put their thing in as the thing's going around and take a selfie. Look at that. Yeah, that's great. That's going on Twitter. That's going to be a Facebook photo for sure. Guys, let's Instagram this. What photo filter should I use? Valencia? No, X-Pro. X-Pro 2. That's great. Idiots. Bunch of idiots. Anywho, but again, people pushed that rule too far, and now they aren't even allowed to be in the parks at all. Nowhere near the parks. Even Disney Quest, which is amazing. So yeah, you ruined it for everybody, guys. Thanks, idiots. Guest relations will be on hand to tag any selfie sticks for storage during the day with a claim ticket given to the guest for pickup on exiting the park. So yes, they will store it for you, because whatever, but they will search bags and do all of that, so they're going to make sure that you do not have your selfie stick on hand. I'm sure all other video and, like photograph paraphernalia is good, but don't use those selfie sticks. So try not to be one of those people and use a selfie stick on the ride because you ruin it for everybody else. So again, thanks, idiots. Moving on. The Interventions West Corridor near the character spot in Epcot's Future World will soon be home to a new relaxation area. Known as a D-Zone, expect to see seating, electronic device charging stations, and a couple of food and drink carts starting early next week. That's next week. The corridor has always been popular with guests to cool off, but the lack of seating has left people just sitting on the floor. So Disney, knowing that, they decided to, well, let's, you know, up the game and give, you know, people a place to sit. The D-Zone relation area concept has began in the Magic Kingdom with the introduction of the Fantasyland Tangle restroom area and the Big Top area in the Storybook Circus. The idea is for people to have a space to cool down, charge their devices, and to take a break from some of the hustle and bustle of the park. So that's really cool that, you know, Disney's doing that, especially the electronic charging stations. You know, that's a big thing now. Everybody has a device, a mobile device, and charging them during the day is a big thing. Usually, you know, just being able to charge it once during the middle of the day gives your, you know, kind of, it relaxes you. You can go grab a snack, charge your phone or whatever, and then you can move on and still have a good full thing. So that's really cool. I like that. Good guy, Disney. According to Disney's FastPass Plus, this is interesting, Captain EO... Why? Captain EO will be returning to Epcot on July 19th. One of the things we didn't need, but okay. FastPass Plus availability for Captain EO is now available on the My Disney Experience app for dates from July 19th onward. Captain EO has been absent since April 1st for an extended movie trailer of Tomorrowland and then Inside Out. The long-term future of Captain EO is in doubt, however, with a makeover of the entire Imagination Pavilion is expected. Some had questioned if Captain EO would even return at all during the, you know, once the movie premieres were done. But its inclusion in FastPass Plus would suggest otherwise, well, at least for the short term. So, hey. Okay, I guess they figured they had to put something in there so they'd bring Captain EO back. And, yeah. Okay, moving on. The dates are now available for the 2015 winter refurbishments of both Walt Disney World water parks. This year, Blizzard Beach will be closing first, with its refurbishment beginning on October 25th through to January 2nd, and Typhoon Lagoon will then close for its refurbishment on January 3rd through to March 12th. Considering some of the stuff was leaking, I'm pretty sure they're going to be doing a heavy-duty refurbishment, so that should be good for that. Just keep that in mind if you're going down. So, yeah, that's the news for this week. A lot of news, a lot of big news. Let's get right to the reviews. Okay, all right. The first thing I want to review for you today is something that I should have reviewed last week, but I didn't get a chance to watch it because I watched Jurassic World for a second time. I still think, yes, I know it's not Disney, but I still love that movie. And the Lego Jurassic World video game is actually hilariously fun, too. I digress, though. Anyway, so the next thing I want to review is Inside Out. It's the newest Disney Pixar movie out. It's available in 2D and 3D, so I saw it in 3D, which was nice. It didn't really do much. The 3D-ness is great, but it didn't take away from the movie, but it didn't add anything as well. So, again, it's just regular 3D or 2D stuff. This was directed by Pete Docter, who also did Up and the Monsters, Inc. and Monsters, he didn't do Monsters University, but he did Monsters, Inc. and all that. And he's a very well-known guy, especially in Pixar. He does a lot of stuff and he works a lot. And, obviously by Up, he's very, very well respected. It's interesting, this movie, I'd only heard about it, a couple months ago, and then I saw the trailer, which looked fantastic, and, I caught on right away. It's actually funny that a lot of the people who were making the film were kind of hesitant to make it because they weren't sure if people could follow such a concept. But I'll get to that in a minute. My experience with the movie, it started off with it being a bunch of previews, obviously. But then, obviously, Pixar has to have a short. The short for this one was called Lava. It's actually a musical. It shows a tropical island. I think it's like a Pacific tropical island. It kind of has a Hawaiian feel to it, I guess. I want to say that, maybe Hawaiian feel to it. And it's an island. He's, a big island, obviously, with a volcano and everything. It's called Lava, and he's just happy to be there, but he wants somebody else to be there with him. He wants a mate. He looks at everything, and there's two of everything but only one of him. So he sings a song, and the song that he sings is the song that you hear in the actual short. You're not hearing it now, but in the actual short itself. But then we find that there's another one underneath the water that hasn't sprouted up yet, because obviously we know islands come from volcanoes and everything like that, and lava being cooled down to bring the mountain up. And what happens is they kind of flip-flop. The one under the water comes up, but the one in the water or top of the water goes down. But eventually, after he hears her song, he comes back up. And they are both together, and this was all inspired by the tropical islands in the Pacific, and it was nice. It was very well done, very heartfelt, and I really enjoyed it. It was very well done. Then we get right into the movie. Now, Inside Out is all about this girl named Riley. She's 11 years old, and we're basically going inside her head and see how all of her decisions and other things like that are made, and they're made from five different feelings. You got joy, fear, sadness, anger, and disgust. Now, all of these are played by fantastic comedians and really great actors in their own right. You got joy, who was played by Amy Poehler. Sadness was played by Phyllis Smith. She's from The Office. Hilarious. Lewis Black plays anger. You couldn't got any better person than Lewis Black to play anger. He was just really good, very Lewis Blackish. Bill Hader was fear. He did a great job. And Mindy Kaling, bringing her in as disgust was great. She really nailed it. All were completely fantastic. And basically, all of the day-to-day stuff for this girl named Riley, everything that she does is has to do with these feelings. How she acts, what she remembers, what she doesn't. She they create memories and stuff like that. It's really neat. Now, her parents, who are mom and dad, obviously played by Diane Lane and Kyle MacLachlan, respectively, they up and move from Minnesota to San Francisco, And Riley is having some problems with that. And we basically, you know, follow what she does for the next 2 days and all the decisions and feelings that go through her head, you know, with trying to remain happy because Joy, Amy Poehler's character, wants everything to be happy and happy all the time. Always happy memories. Always, always, always. But, you know, realistically, we're not always happy as humans. We're not. We do encounter some fear, anger, and even sadness. And the sadness portion really isn't there anymore. She kind of feels neglected. And sometimes sadness is needed in order to feel joy again. So that's kind of the way the whole thing goes. I'm not trying to give away too much, but Joy and sadness get on. You know, they wind up going into some, like, deep memory thoughts, and basically everything goes haywire, and Riley makes some bad decisions, feels some kind of ways about certain things, and it's interesting to see how they get back and get back on track, and, the adventure that they go on is very, very well done. It's just funny to think that there were like think tanks of these adults trying to get into the mind of an 11 or 12 year old girl. Like, what would she be thinking when this happened? What is happening with this? Now, this is all based around Pete Doctor's life and his daughter's life. Back when he was a young guy, Pete Doctor, his family moved to, I think it was like Germany or something, or Belgium or something. And he had a hard time with the move. And he saw, similar things of that in his daughter's life, and that inspired him to kind of make this, like, you know, what is she thinking? Why is she thinking this way? Why was I thinking this way? And they came up with this brilliant idea. Now, this was a movie that had been a long time in the making, because they had to figure out things. They had to figure out the animation style. Just get into the mind of this. Could people understand, you know, the whole idea of, you know, five basic, feelings, making, you know, decisions, and creating memories. So that's pretty neat. And now the music behind this was done by Michael Giacchino, who also did Up and The Incredibles. And he also did Jurassic World, which was funny. Why is that funny? Well, because right now, Inside Out and Jurassic World are kind of going head to head with the with the ratings. Inside Out debuted to a fantastic opening, $90 million. That's actually, I think, like, what was it, $13 million over Avatar's opening weekend, which actually beat. It's now has the world record for highest grossing non-sequel-oriented intellectual property. Basically, you know, this is the highest grossing movie that wasn't a sequel or wasn't based on a book or a superhero or something like that. So they did it did a lot of money. It was made for $175 million. It currently is at around $188 million, so it's past its mark. And that's the second week, and I guarantee it's just gonna get higher and higher. This was a very good movie. Now, my personal opinion on this, it's a tough one. I really enjoyed the movie, but I found it hard to kind of relate to the characters. But that, again, that's just me, because everybody else that I talked to related to something else about it. And I understand, because when you're talking about feelings and whatnot, especially a movie that has, you know, certain plot points, if you've never experienced those plot points, yes, you can empathize with the person or the character, but you can't, you know, get in really in their head. So for me, there wasn't a heart-gripping moment that made me go, oh man, you know, kind of like Toy Story 3 did, or even Up. But that doesn't mean that it won't do it for you. A lot of people love this movie and, you know, consider this one of the great Pixar movies ever. I really enjoyed it, but for me, there are a couple, you know, better Pixar movies, or at least movies that register more with my psyche and my, feelings and whatnot. So, don't take me, you know, not getting fully invested in this movie as a negative thing. It's just because I just couldn't really relate to being a 12-year-old girl, because I'm a 30-year-old man. But I can, I could relate to some things, but it wasn't anything major, I guess, if that's the way to say. I really enjoyed it. So what am I going to give Disney Pixar's Inside Out? I'm going to give this a solid 4. This was a very good movie. I really enjoyed it. It's not a 5 because I couldn't directly empathize with the character, you know, the main character, but that again is just me. It's just, you know, that is me putting myself into the movie. As a movie itself, it's great. I totally enjoyed it, and it was funny, and I loved the voice acting. It was awesome, and I urge you guys to go check this out. It's out in theaters right now, 2D and 3D. Inside Out, Disney Pixar, 4 stars. Check it out.
And now, a random Disney fact with File91e.
When Disneyland opened 60 years ago, there were only 17 main attractions. Today, there's over 60.
And that was a random Disney fact with File91e.
Alright guys, the next thing I want to talk to you about today is Splash Mountain. This is a summer attraction, you know, just great because you get splashed and it's awesome. It's, you know, obviously it's really appreciated during the summer when you're really hot. You're out in the heat of the Disney parks and you want to get a little splash to cool you down. You go to Splash Mountain, especially if you're going to Disneyland Park. Now what these guys say Splash Mountain is, a water flume adventure boat ride, headliner, go before 9:45 a.m. or use Fast Pass. A wet winter not to be missed, must be 40 inches tall to ride. Those age 7 or younger must ride with an adult, switching off option provided. They gave it 4.5 stars. Now this is located in Critter Country in Disneyland Park, and it's pretty much, it's the only thing in Critter Country aside from, oh yeah, no, there's the Many Adventures of Winnie the Pooh. This opened on July 17th in 1989. And this was one of the first log flume rides that Disney ever created. They didn't really want to because, well, every ride, every amusement park has a log flume ride. But this is a log flume ride on steroids. They really did the Disney touch with this is off the maps, off the charts. Really, really cool stuff. There's also one, obviously, in the Magic Kingdom and in Tokyo Disneyland, and both, or all of them, are actually roughly the same. I mean, there's not too many differences, you know, between them, although some do have, aside from different, themed variables or something like that, they're not a whole lot different. Now, the main theme of this ride is based off the 1946 Disney movie, Song of the South. Because this is actually one of the first movies that mixed live action with animation. So they pretty much just kept to the animated parts and took those characters and made this ride. It was a good themed ride for Critter Country and the kind of the frontier area. So why not? That was good enough for this ride. This ride was formulated by Tony Baxter, Disney legend, Imagineer Tony Baxter. He was sitting in traffic when he, you know, thought of this thing up, and he was like, you know what, let's do something with this area. It's a log flume ride, let's use like some different things, because you got the America Sings attraction that used to be there. They were able to reuse a lot of the stuff from that to keep the cost down, and overall I think it worked out pretty well. That's one of the more popular attractions in the parks, and totally worth your time to go see it. Now the ride itself is pretty, you know, basic. You hop into this log flume, but the wait itself is really nice because you go through the Brer Rabbit's tunnels and things like that, and you hop into the log flume and you go on the journey with Brer Rabbit, and it takes place, you know. They took all the stories from Song of the South, the animated stories, and kind of mushed them together. And you go through all the different things, and there's a lot of different songs there, like the Laugh and Play song and Zippity-Doo-Dah, obviously. There are a couple really small drops there before the big 50-foot drop, which is what it's known for. And you will get a little wet when you, splash down at the end of Splash Mountain. It's a very fun ride. I have some video. I want to show it to you. That's why I'm not really talking too much about it. But it was a very fun ride. I really enjoyed it. And it's very well themed. The animatronics in it are great. The song cues and whatnot are great. And the fact that there's a couple little smaller drops to kind of get you, oh my god, are we here? No, we're not there yet. But you know you're going for the big drop when you go up that big ramp. And they're threatening Brer Rabbit and whatnot, and you drop down, and whew, man, that is a good 50-foot drop. It's very exciting, very exhilarating. It happens really quick, though, you know, and it just builds up your suspense. That was really good. So I have some video of Splash Mountain that I want to show you guys. So watch this video of Splash Mountain. This is my footage on it, and I hope you guys enjoyed it. So here we go, Splash Mountain. Check it out.
Oh my God.
So there you go. That's the Disneyland version of Splash Mountain. It's not really, again, you know, like I said, it's not a whole lot different between the Disney World version and the Disneyland version. I think the Disney World version is actually a little bit longer than the Disneyland version, but they're essentially the same. They don't really, you know, the track might vary a little bit from time to time, but it's not anything different. I love the final drop. We actually wound up going on it twice, because the first time we went on it, we got there, you know, at the park really early, and we went directly to Splash Mountain to get that done. And sure enough, nobody was there. It was awesome. We got on it, did it, and we just kind of went right through. It was great. We did get a little soaked. We kind of pressed our luck. We didn't get soaked the first time, but we got soaked the second time, and we wound up, you know, having wet butts for the remainder of the day, which isn't too fun, but it wasn't bad because I think I was wearing a dark color that day, so it wasn't too bad. Hopefully it dried off a little faster. Okay, guys, so now it's time for the Nate rating. He said 4.3. If you like walking around wet, then it might be higher, but I don't. So 4.3. I am giving this 5 big stars. This is one of the things you have to hit every single time you go to Disney World. It's great. Again, you will get wet, so I've heard or actually seen people wear, like, you know, trash bags over their stuff to try to prevent themselves from getting wet, you know, like getting themselves wet. I often find that it's usually the shoes area and the butt area that gets wet the most, but I could be wrong. Depends on where you're actually sitting in the actual log flume. So yeah, there is that. So yeah, 5 stars. So I love Splash Mountain. It's one of my favorites. And I urge you guys to check it out each and every single time you go down to Disney World. A great ride for everybody. Just make sure that you can, you know, still, you know, fit on it and whatnot. You don't want to wait through the whole long line and not be able to actually get on it. And yes, this does get long lines, so get a fast pass or get there early. So Splash Mountain at Disneyland Park, 5 big stars. Well, I hope you guys enjoyed this week's Disney News and Reviews. Again, in August, I'm going to be doing that kind of battle arena thing, so I'm really excited about that. And I want to do a live Q&A again. I'm not sure when I'm going to do that. I just haven't done that in a while, and that was fun the other time. It was really good. But yeah, if anybody from Disney is watching, please don't sue me. I want people to go to Disney, you know, World or Disneyland, any of them, and just have a great time. Check out Inside Out. It's out in theaters right now in 2D and 3D, so a really good movie there. I really urge you guys to check that out. And if you're in Disney World or Disneyland, go to Splash Mountain. I know it's hot as heck down there, so go to Splash Mountain, get a little soaked, and actually do that at the end of the day so that when you squeak to your car or squeak to your hotel room, you won't have to worry about being wet, you know, wet socks or wet feet too much. If you are going to Disney World or Disneyland, be sure to go to ours.net, touringplans.com, www.magic.com for our latest and greatest Disney news. MiceChat.com is where I get my Disneyland stuff. They haven't really been updating too much about Disney land, but I do check every week, and when there's some good stuff for you, I will mention it. So yeah, last week you got the Where in the Land pretty good, so I want to try to stump you this time. So guys, I'll see you next week for the 4th of July celebration, and Where in the Land am I this week? Bye guys.